This is the Tinkers Creek Aqueduct along the Ohio and Erie Canal in Cuyahoga Valley National Park. I'm Darren, and this is the Industrial Revolution. So first, let's get this out of the way. What actually is an aqueduct? It's not something you see a lot of. You used to see a lot more in the days of canals. Aqueducts have been around for thousands of years. The Romans used them to bring water into their cities. Here on the canal, the aqueduct was used to get canal boats over the tops of other things that were in the way. In this case, it gets you over the top of Tinkers Creek. In some cases, it'd go over the top of large valleys. There's a huge one over in England that's still in use by canal boats today that crosses a huge valley. But what are we actually looking at here? Well, so this is not the original aqueduct. This is the third version of this aqueduct. This is the fourth version of this aqueduct. It's the second location for the aqueduct. The original aqueduct was built back that way a short distance towards the Cuyahoga River, which is 100 feet away here. After flooding wiped that one out twice, they moved it up here. But it's kind of the same design as the original. So the original aqueduct over here was wiped out in flooding in 1845. That was just 20 years after it was built. They rebuilt it, and it got knocked out again in 2005, and that's when they relocated it upriver a little bit to try to protect it from future flooding. This aqueduct lasted for quite a while, far outlasted the canal itself. Well, in 2007, the canal was in pretty rough shape. This was leaking, and they were trying to get the canal sort of restored, sort of back, maybe even usable. And it's not fully there today, but they are making progress. The towpath trail, if you've seen people walking and biking across here, there's a towpath trail. This canal was actually originally intended to move canal boats, and it lasted until massive flooding statewide just wiped out so much of the canal infrastructure, just wasn't worth restoring anymore. In this case, it's being restored for recreational purposes. But you can still see you have this huge trough behind here that's supported on the original stone piers and a towpath trail above it. In this case, you have a concrete trough for the canal to go through and steel I-beams. Originally, as I mentioned, it's just a steel truss. And that wasn't true with the 1905 version as well. You had a steel truss and wood troughs to support everything. The towpath next to it was all wood. And the towpath was necessary for your mules to come down as the mules towed the canal boats along. So the canal is actually mostly drained today, and that's why the water is so low. Originally, of course, you would have had a minimum 4-foot depth in the canal, and that includes the 4-foot depth in the aqueduct and the locks as well. This is the 90-foot long trough, and if you look at the beginning here, right before we get started onto the aqueduct itself, you'll see we have a metal plate going down. And that metal plate and the one on this side allow you to remove the metal plate and drop temporary dams in, and then you can actually drain the aqueduct completely for maintenance. And there's another one just like it over on the other side. So as we cross the towpath here, keep in mind that the water would have been up much closer to the top of this aqueduct. In fact, there's a depth gauge at the other side. We'll take a look at that when we get over there. The channel here is 22 feet wide. And 22 feet is much wider than the locks and much narrower than the canal itself. Everywhere on the canal, it was designed to allow you to have one boat pass another. You could even have a boat tied up at the side and pass it. Locks, of course, would fit exactly one canal boat and nothing more than that. This was wider. It let you pass through considerably quicker. However, you were not able to pass in here. So think of it as a one-lane road. If we look here on the far side, you can see the depth gauge. You can see the water right now is just barely over a foot. They have the water shut off coming into the canal. This is actually just seepage. Everything that's in here is just seeped into the canal at this point. And one more interesting thing, if you look over on the other side, you see these two valves. And that was something that was also common. You'd have those on aqueducts. Those are spoil gates. It allows you to do two things. First thing you could do with them is if you closed off the canal, close off the aqueduct by putting those temporary dams in, you were able to then drain the aqueduct for maintenance. It also let you pull off excess water from the canal. As you can see, this canal is a little bit dry right now.
One interesting feature of aqueducts is that, unlike bridges used by cars, the load on the aqueduct is actually the same whether there's a boat on it or not. A boat will displace its own weight of water, and with speed limit only 4 miles per hour, there's no real wake to be concerned about either. In the 100 or so years that it was out of service, the aqueduct became somewhat overgrown. This concrete aqueduct and the restored towpath trail continued the restoration work of the National Park Service and the Cleveland Metro Parks to restore this critical part of history.
So if you're like me, you probably don't think a whole lot about things like this, about, you know, how do you get a canal boat over the top of a stream or river or valley. But if you're building a canal, these are critical. The only option to this sort of structure would have been over here, you put a lock down from the canal to the water level, cross the water, and then put a lock back up and continue. And here, it's short enough you could do it with one lock on each side. In some places, you're looking at lock after lock after lock. And locks are very, very expensive to build. These aren't cheap, but they're a whole lot cheaper and a whole lot more efficient than building two locks and operating two locks and dealing with the traffic congestion from the two locks. So aqueducts like this are in fact essential. And that's why this is the Industrial Revolution. Hey, before you go, I do need your help to keep this channel going and also to help keep it growing. Easiest thing you can do to help is just to click the like button. Also, if you can do subscribe and notify, then you'll know when I release new videos and you'll be able to watch those. Also, I have a Patreon page over at patreon.com/industrialrevolution. And if you have any questions, comments, places you think I should go visit, please leave those down in the comments section of the video. That's actually the best way to tell YouTube, hey, this is a channel worth watching. Thanks for watching, and I look forward to seeing you at the next one.